Good evening again, everyone, and welcome to our Passaic County Freeholder Conference Agenda meeting. We have a very short conference agenda, but a very exciting one, in which we will be honoring some outstanding students from our very own Passaic County Tech. With that being said, we'll now have roll call.
Freeholders Duffy.
Here.
James.
Here.
Lazara.
Here.
Lepore. Laura.
Here.
Deputy Director Bartlett.
Here.
Director Best.
Here. Tell me what it is.
Sure. Director, as many people may have read in the newspaper, certainly it has been all over social media. Our vocational school, PCTI, was recognized as being named the number one school in the nation by WISE that's working in support of education, certification program. We are honored to have one of the supervisors here with us today, along with other folks, which I'll ask you to do. Common Kula, who also doubles as the mayor of our school, as well as the president of our school. I want to come all of you. Just somewhere we the mic will pick you up. I want a pretty glass.
Your honors, good evening. It's a pleasure and honor to be here with you as the supervisor of instruction for the Academy of Finance and the School of Business at our fine institution of education, Passaic County Technical Institute. I have with me the senior teachers for the Academy of Finance, Ms. Jalissa Verbone and Mr. Richard Glick. Also, there are one of our three fine students who will be introduced by their teachers. But the reason we are here is to present the freeholders with the trophies that we received on April 11th. We were invited by WISE, which is a nonprofit organization focused on educating students financially. There's been a competition on a yearly basis based on a test. The competition has been running for 4 years, and next week they'll be our students will be testing, it'll be the fifth year. But in 4 years of competition, Passaic County Technical Institute was ranked first in the nation twice, including based on their performance last year, which you have the trophy for, the blue one. We were recognized as the number one school in the nation in terms of large schools, and also as the number one school in the nation overall. So that includes middle-sized schools and small schools. We have 100% passing rate with an average passing rate of 93%. So we have the trophies and the banners, which I will ask the students if they can lift up the banner. It's definitely a prestigious award. They were given the honor at the Federal Reserve Building, and that's where it happens every single year. WISE is sponsored by major corporations, so there's behind it are major institutions that care about the financial health of our nation. I'm going to turn the floor over to Ms. Verbone and Mr. Glick as I share with you copies of The Technician, which is our quarterly newsletter, which has the news of our WISE financial achievement. Ms. Verbone and then Mr. Glick.
Okay, so I'm going to introduce the students. This is Nicole Gravier, Raj Rana, and Chelsea Sanfan. They're both seniors. They both will be graduating this June from the Academy of Finance. I actually had the pleasure of having all three of them in my class last year, and I have one of them in my senior class this year. And just so you're aware of the topics that are covered, we know that, you know, being financially literate is one of the most important things, you know, when you begin your career, no matter what career you go into. And the students are taught over the topics of money, banking, credit, insurance, investments, and many more topics. And we're taught throughout the whole year, and we pretty much prep all year long. And it was an honor to be there this year and last year. and as an alumni of the Academy of Finance, because I am a graduate of PCTI from the same program that I teach in. So it's exciting to see, you know, what has happened over the years and what is still happening, you know, today.
All right, thank you very much. Well, it's been a privilege this year to have Chelsea and Nicole in our class as seniors this year. It's important to understand that in New Jersey, overall, across the country, we find a lot of students aren't prepared financially as they leave high school to get into the working world. State of New Jersey, it is required that they do pass school and have credits to graduate. But more than that, it's a lifelong skill that the kids need to understand. Because once they graduate to adulthood, after college, adulthood, working, whatever, financial skills are what they're going to have throughout their lifetime. So Wise Financial Literacy does a great job in recognizing the students that we should know. And I've got it at the State County Technical Institute. You know, we have a great program here, great teachers, great students, and really, they help make the program help the kids.
I know that Fielder was there. You have a proclamation that we're going to present to teachers and the students.
I couldn't be happier than to present this proclamation to these students and new teachers from Passaic County Technical Institute. I'm going to just read real quick what the proclamation says. Whereas the Board of Chosen Freeholders of the County of Passaic has a desire to recognize Passaic County Technical Institute upon being named as the number one school in the nation by the Wise Financial Literacy Certification Program. And whereas WISE and the WSA stands for Working in Support of Education Organization is a leading nonprofit organization in New York City with a mission to improve the lives of young people through programs that develop financial literacy and readiness for college and the workforce. And whereas the announcement naming the 2016 ranking of the 100 best WISE high schools reaching teaching personal finance was made at a special ceremony held at the Federal Reserve Bank of New York on April 11, 2016, where the Passaic County Technical Institute was presented with trophies and a banner, and its NJROTC color guard was invited to conduct a presentation of colors at the event, along with teachers and students. And whereas this award comes in light of exemplary results on the program's financial literacy certification test, which proves that Passaic County Technical Institute is successfully educating its students and preparing them for the future. And whereas the finance students of the Passaic County Technical Institute achieved a 100% passing rate on the certification test with scores averaging an outstanding 95%, and the school received top accolades in the large high school category, where they were also ranked number one. And whereas their families, community, county, and state have every reason to be proud of this outstanding achievement, and this board joins with Passaic County Technical Institute in celebrating this momentous occasion. Now, therefore, let it be proclaimed by the Board of Chosen Freeholders of the County of Passaic that it publicly acknowledges and extends its most heartfelt congratulations to the finance students, teachers, and staff at the Passaic County Technical Institute upon the school being named, and this is the words, number one in the nation by the WISE Financial Literacy Certification Program, and be it further proclaimed that this board expresses its sincere best wishes to the Passaic County Technical Institute and its students for continued success. I congratulate all of you. I know it must have been a long, arduous journey, and I applaud each and every one of you.
Mr. Carulla, we're going to have a chance to hear from one of the students.
Sure.
Okay. You can use the microphone as you...
You want to say
something? Can you use the microphone only so it could carry on the TV station?
I'd like to thank all of you for coming out here and acknowledging our efforts into, you know, making this happen. So thank you to all of you.
Thank you for acknowledging us and letting everybody know that we do things and that we are getting places and that it is important to be financially literate. And it is important that our schools and our schools and the majors and the things that we learn at school are still important.
So I would just like to thank our teachers for helping us learn all these great things and for making our school number one ranked in the nation. Thank you.
Any questions for us, Mr. Director? I just want to publicly thank the freeholders for their support of Passaic County Technical Institute. Thank you very much.
The original motion was a motion to come out of
executive session.
Yes, this motion now is a motion to adjourn. Motion made by Freeholder James, second by Freeholder Bartlett.
Freeholders Duffy?
Here.
James?
Yes.
Pizarra?
Yes.
LaFour? Laura?
Yes.
Deputy Director Bartlett? Director Best?
Yes. And now we will roll right into our regular meeting for this evening. We'll start by reading the Open Public Meetings Law.
Ladies and gentlemen, the notice requirement of the Open Public Meetings Law has been satisfied with respect to this meeting, specifying the time, date, and location, including the annual notice adopted the reorganization meeting filed with the county clerk, posted in the administration building, and mailed to two newspapers in accordance with the provisions of the law.
Thank you. Roll call.
Freeholders Duffy?
Here.
James?
Here.
Lazara?
Here.
LaFour? Laura?
Here.
Deputy Director Bartlett?
Here.
Director Best?
Here. I'm going to ask that everyone please rise for our invocation of the Pledge of Allegiance and special announcements.
Freeholder Laura?
Blessed are you, Lord. We thank you for this opportunity once again. We gather together to do business of the county of Passaic. We ask that you guide us. You would give us wisdom, insight, and compassion for all decisions made, all over the past. It would be first and foremost in the best interest of all of the residents of this county, as well as what I'm for helping this community.
Amen.
Yo,
Duffy, can you use the flag to
the flag? My honor. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, liberty and justice for all.
I ask that everyone please remain standing for a special moment of silence for all the brave men and women who lost their lives while serving this country. Also wanted to remind everybody that this is our National Military Appreciation Month. Thank you. Entertain a motion to approve minutes for April 26, 2016. Moved by Freeholder Lazara. Second by Freeholder LaFour. Roll call, please.
Freeholders Duffy.
Abstain.
James.
Yes.
Lazara.
Yes.
LaFour.
Yes.
Laura.
Yes.
Deputy Director Bartlett.
Yes.
Director Best.
Yes. Entertain a motion to suspend the regular order of business. Moved by Freeholder James. Second by Freeholder Lazara. Roll call.
Freeholders Duffy,
yes.
James,
yes.
Lazara,
yes.
LaFour,
yes.
Laura,
yes.
Deputy Director Bartlett,
yes.
Director Best.
Yes. We now have the reading of Bond Ordinance 2016-06.
Director, for the record, the original agenda that was sent out on Friday afternoon had the wrong description for H1. The correct description is now on in front of all of you, and it is an amended agenda. So, just for the record. Bond ordinance 2016-06. Bond ordinance amending bond ordinance number 2015-07, finally adopted by the Board of Chosen Fields of the County of Passaic, New Jersey, on April 28, 2015.
Entertain a motion to open a public hearing on bond ordinance 2016-06. Moved by Freeholder Laporte. Second by Freeholder Bartlett. Roll call, please.
Freeholders Duffy.
Yes.
James.
Yes.
Lazara.
Yes.
Lepore.
Yes.
Laura.
Yes.
Deputy Director Bartlett.
Yes.
Director Best.
Yes. Before we open a public portion, I'm going to ask for a quick explanation of this from our county administrator.
This is the amendment on the Westbrook Road Bridge. There was additional cost to the bridge. This is a federally funded bridge. So this is monies that will be reimbursed to us from the federal government. We had to increase the bond ordinance to account for the total expenditure. And I believe, Mr. Edmund, Mr. Cahill, we've already gotten the commitment letter from the federal government.
We have the federal agreement that we will execute at the next meeting.
Okay, so we have the commitment from the federal government that the monies will be added.
Thank you, Mr. Administrator. At this time, anyone wishing to be heard on bond ordinance 2016-06, please approach the podium.
Seeing no one at the podium, move to close the public hearing.
Second.
Motion made by Freeholder Duffy, second by Freeholder Laporte. Roll call, please.
Freeholder Duffy.
Yes.
James.
Yes.
Lazara.
Yes.
Lepore.
Yes.
Laura.
Yes.
Deputy Director Bartlett.
Yes.
Director Best.
Yes. Time to entertain a motion to approve or adopt bond ordinance 2016-06.
Make that motion.
Moved by Freeholder Duffy, second by Freeholder James. Roll call, please.
Freeholders Duffy.
Yes.
James.
Yes.
Lazara.
Yes.
Lepore.
Yes.
Laura.
Yes.
Deputy Director Bartlett.
Yes.
Director Best.
Yes. Entertain a motion to resume regular order of business. Moved by Freeholder Laura, second by Freeholder Duffy. Roll call.
Freeholders Duffy.
Yes.
James.
Yes.
Lazara.
Yes.
Lepore.
Yes.
Laura.
Yes.
Deputy Director Bartlett.
Yes.
Director Best.
Yes. Entertain a motion to approve proclamations. Mm-hmm. Moved by Freeholder Lepore. I'm sorry. Moved by Freeholder Laura. Second by Freeholder Lepore. You got to roll call, please.
Freeholders Duffy.
Yes.
James.
Yes.
Lazara.
Yes.
Lepore.
Yes.
Laura.
Yes.
Deputy Director Bartlett.
Yes.
Director Best?
Yes. Freeholder reports.
Me.
Ladies first. Freeholder Lazara.
So, you know, we have departments that do a lot to help the people of Passaic County. And over the last 2 weeks, I've had the pleasure of working with a couple of the departments and helping our citizens. So I just wanted to give a shout out to them. One of them is in the Senior Disability Services and Veterans Affairs, led by Mary Kaczynski. I think Mary's here. There you are. So Sam Yodis is a director for Weatherization and Home Energy Program. And that program, they apply for grants where they get money, and then they help make energy bills more affordable for those less fortunate that need a little bit of help weatherizing and doing the energy in their homes. I just want to tell you that some of the money that has been giving out in the last year that I think is phenomenal, it's a big help. One of them goes to our senior Sienna Village in Wayne. They were awarded $188,000 to replace windows and hot water heaters. In Passaic, Monsignor Joseph Bristol residence was given $506,678, which saves them every single year for over $14,000 in energy bills. This is great work that Sam is doing in conjunction with the rest of his department and with Mary helping these people. And the second thing is our workforce development board. The department head is Chris Irvin. And Chris put together a seminar for 7th to 12th graders. I was there this past Saturday. And It's called, and it's a mouthful, hold on. Passaic County Healthcare Career Fair. So 7th to 12th graders from throughout the county were invited to come up to the Safety Center on Alden Road and Wayne. And 75 children and their families came out to learn about all different careers in healthcare. And that included doctors. One boy wants to be a cardiac surgeon. They covered dentists. They covered occupational therapists. They talked to the kids about EOF funding, which is educational opportunity funding. Councilwoman Moritz of DeVille from Patterson, who works at Passaic County Community College, came and sat down with the kids and told them exactly how to apply for funding so that they can continue their educational careers. These are programs that someone like Chris Irving and Sam Duke, it doesn't matter the time of day, this one program was on Saturday, and I need to recognize them because I think they should be. So this is my way of saying to them, they did a good job, and I look forward to more reports like this so that I can share them with the public so that the public knows exactly what we're doing. Thanks.
Director, my neighbor has the podium. Let me jump in and just give a shout out to Deborah Hoffman. What a great job you did with the film. I'm sorry I wasn't there. You know, you had a whole front cover of the newspaper. Great job. You know, well done, as usual.
Sure. For James.
I'm going to actually embarrass somebody. I'm going to ask Karen Sisko to come on up or get up. Yep. We're going to speak to you. You are a person who provides emergency medical services as a volunteer.
Yeah.
Well, she handed me a proclamation from the governor's office. May 15th through May 21st is Emergency Medical Services Week.
Right.
Largely performed by volunteers in all of our towns, and it's an essential service. It saves thousands of lives throughout the state every year. Got anything you want to say? I know, I'm putting you on the spot, but you're not doing that.
There are countless volunteer emergency medical technicians and people in just emergency medical services throughout Passaic County that get up morning, noon, and night, in the middle of the night, in the blizzards. They stand by their first aid buildings, all for the better sake of the people. You have a district that covers these first responders, and it's nice, and I thank you for pointing it out to the general public that it is Emergency Services Week, whereas we will turn around and go to the schools and promote emergency services to get people to join the first aid squads and the fire departments, and if not, go on to the police departments or the military, just to be a positive role model for the kids in the county. So
let me ask you a question. How difficult is it these days getting volunteers for these kinds of services?
It's extremely difficult. Their heart is in the right place. However, the state has made it very difficult for the general person to become a EMT. You must have a minimum of a certain number of EMTs in every ambulance. When I started some time ago, I needed 5 points to be a first aid squad member. I needed CPR, defensive driving, a couple of different things, emergency childbirth. Now they have an EMT course. I was an EMT instructor, and the class was 120 hours. Volunteer, just to go, and you have to pay several hundred dollars to take an EMT class nowadays by the time you put your medical services and everything else in. And we're still getting people to do that. So I'm impressed by that factor, but it's getting more and more difficult.
And the cost is a factor too, so they volunteer and they have to pay for their own training?
Absolutely, yeah. The township and and they've been good about it. The various different townships and the municipality, they've been wonderful. And they kind of back up with a budget of some sort for that sort of activity to take place so the members can go. But
I think the county college chips in too. We had a big meeting. If you remember, we had a huge meeting on this issue. I want to say maybe 5 years ago now, when all the towns were invited. So we came to some kind of compromise on it. But I was wondering how it was working out, because it was expensive then. I didn't realize it was getting more and more expensive.
I can only speak for my first aid squads in the borough of Montague. We were at our lowest. I think we were down to 17 people covering 11,500 citizens from the borough of Montague. And because of pushing and getting the younger people who are transitioning from high school into a field of work in the medical fields, and they want to become people that help the community. Plus, they wanted to use it for the college credits as well. So therefore, we're now up to, I think it's 29 people on board right now. So right now, we're in good shape. But the problem is, again, during the day, years and years ago, it used to be that, you know, the wife stayed home, not to be sexist or anything else, but the wife stayed home and they watched the children while the children were in school. They had the availability to go out on ambulance calls. Now with today's economy, it's completely different.
Everybody works,
if not one job, two part-time jobs or something during the day. So that's made a big, really affected the daytime ambulance calls. I know we've gone on, I believe the number was over 1,100 calls just in a small town of Wanaka in 2015.
Well, this board thanks everybody who volunteers and provides this service. It's a critical service.
Thank you very much, and I'll pass that on to our members who will turn around and go back to our district. This is the 17th district that covers most municipalities in the borough, in the county of the city, to make sure that they mention at the district meetings. Thank you.
Thanks.
Hello, James. Thank you, Karen. You can have a seat. I won't make you stand up anymore. But I am going to talk about you just a little bit. While Karen's making her way back to her chair, I just wanted to again wish her luck on this Monday's golf outing and the beginning for this season's summer, where at Camp Hope we provide recreational opportunities to youth throughout the county of Passaic. I think we're up to how many this year? We're going to serve 3,000?
We'll probably, with the junior counselors, we should hit 2,900.
2,900.
Yeah.
Okay, and I think that's a record for us in the county of Passaic.
Yep.
And throughout the year, obviously, we serve the young at heart as well, too, our seniors who enjoy time up at Camp Hope. And I just wanted to talk a little bit about the golf outing that's going to take place this Monday. It's being sponsored by a phenomenal non-for-profit called Give the Kids Hope Foundation, which was really started to provide supplemental funding for Camp Hope in particular, as well as other camps serving needy children throughout northern New Jersey. Stephen Tilton from Schumacher Chevrolet is the chair of the foundation, and through their great work over the course of the last several years, they've been able, through private donations, to help us in having a new arts and crafts center at Camp Hope, a brand new swimming pool and spray pad, new basketball court, new bocce ball court, and we're also working on a new media center for the students, hopefully for the kids that are coming in the future. So it's a great, wonderful program that they've been able to help us out with. And again, I also wanted to mention New York Jets' very own David Harris, who actually sponsors the golf outing along with the Give the Hope Kids Hope Foundation. So Karen, thank you, and your staff, all of the great work that you guys do up in West Milford. You're not forgotten. We do appreciate you, and good luck on Monday. Tony and myself will be there. Anybody else going? Pat's going to, he's going to go, but he's not going to play.
He's caddying.
Okay, Pat, you have something to say?
Yes, sir, Director. Thank you. Included in the consent agenda, the resolution calling for the banning of the sale of puppy and kitten of dogs and cats from pet shops. A significant number of puppies and kittens sold at pet shops from large-scale commercial breeding facilities where health and welfare of animals are not adequately provided. According to the Humane Society, it is estimated there are 10,000 puppy mills that produce more than 2.4 million puppies a year, and that most pet shop dogs and cats come from puppy mills and kitten mills. The inhumane condition and puppy and kittenville facilities lead to health behavioral issues in animals bred at these facilities, which many consumers are unaware of when purchasing animals from these pet shops due to lack of education on the issues and misleading tactics of pet shops. Even health behavioral issues may not be present themselves until sometime after the purchase of the animals can impose an exorbitant financial and emotional cost on consumers. According to the New Jersey Department of Health, more than 20,000 dogs and cats are euthanized in New Jersey animal shelters annually. Across the county, thousands of independent pet shops, as well as large chains, operate profitably with a business model focused on the sale of pet services and supplies and not on the sale of cats and dogs. Many of these shops collaborate with local animal shelters and rescue organizations to offer space and support for showcasing adoptable homeless pets on their premises. I'm asking that we join five other counties who have started this effort to ban the sale of puppy middle dogs and cats in the state of New Jersey. And I appreciate the Administration Planning Committee for voting for the approval of the board. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other freeholders have a report? Okay, I do want to mention one more item that we're going to be voting on today, and that is Resolution N10, which is declaring Tuesday, July 5th as the Larry Doby Day throughout Passaic County. As many people know, Larry Doby is a Patterson native who was the second African-American to play Major League Baseball. And on July 5th, he actually broke the color barrier in the American League. He had a phenomenal baseball career. He won the World Series, and he's entered into the Hall of Fame. And more so than just baseball, he truly is a humanitarian, a great guy, and a great role model. He's been recognized throughout the city of Patterson, and the county has decided that it's time for us to recognize him as well. And we're going to have a whole series of events that week. But we wanted to start off by officially recognizing July 5th as Larry Doby Day in the county of Passaic. Just wanted to point that out there. And Freeholder Laura, you wanted to say something about this as well? You sure? Okay. He just said he wants to throw out the first pitch at the game. Okay. All right, that being said, we're going to move on. Agenda here. Okay, entering the motion to approve communications.
Second.
Moved by Freeholder LaForce, second by Freeholder Lazara. Roll call.
Freeholder Stuffy.
Yes.
James.
Yes.
Lazara.
Yes.
LaForce.
Yes.
Laura.
Yes.
Deputy Director Bartlett.
Yes.
Director Best.
Yes. At this time, enter to a motion to open the public portion of our meeting. Moved by Freeholder Laura.
Second.
Second by Freeholder LaForce. Roll call, please.
Freeholder Stuffy,
yes.
James,
yes.
Lazara,
yes.
LaForce,
yes.
Laura,
yes.
Deputy Director Bartlett, yes. Director Best.
Yes. At this time, anyone wishing to be heard, I ask you please come up to the podium. You have 3 minutes to speak. Remember that everything you say is part of public record. We ask for your name and address, please. Thank you.
Jane Cohen, 2319 Warren's Way, Wanakee. First of all, I'd like to say I did see Larry go to play baseball. But I'm a lot older than you guys. I congratulate those students from Passaic Tech for doing well for their school. They really honored their school. Financial literacy is very important. They proved that they were the best. I'm not saying anything. You know, I've spoken a number of times about Passaic Tech. I'm not saying anything against Passaic Tech. It's a fine institution. All I am asking for is the freeholders consider the impact that the Passaic Tech has on the local school districts. Passaic Tech collects tax levy monies from the freeholders. It also has a huge amount of federal and state monies that go with the student. So when a student leaves X amount, X school in the district, that money goes with the student to Passaic Tech. So in a sense, it's not just the tuition that the schools are losing, they're losing the federal funding and state funding that they would get for those students. Passaic Tech has a budget of and I can only check from 2 years ago online, of over $70 million. They collect 38.992161 from the school districts. They had a huge amount of state and federal aid. This really has impact on the local districts, and I know that I was told that the Passaic Tech, the superintendents would meet at Passaic Tech, and I know that meeting didn't go as well as some of you may think it did, because I know the superintendents were very angry, and they're still angry about the amount of monies that are drained from their schools at Passaic to go to Passaic Tech. Passaic Tech is not a tradition, it's not the kind of vocational school some people are telling me it is. They're not really preparing students for the world of work. 80% of those students go to college. They're preparing students, and they're doing a good job. They're preparing them to go to college. They're not preparing them to go out to the workforce as the old traditional vocational schools did. They're not producing the plumbers and the carpenters and the auto mechanics that the old district that used to be in a vocational school. All I ask that you do, and by the way, Passaic Tech has the highest paid employee in the county of Passaic. The superintendent is the highest paid employee. The administrative costs in Passaic Tech are enormous. Superintendent makes almost $250,000 a year in salary, and they have a deputy superintendent who makes close to $200,000 a year. It's really impacting the local educational systems. And I ask that you look into this and do an impact study on what's happening. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Ellen DeLodge, 547 Clifton Avenue, Clifton. I have the Passaic County future draft plan January 2013. Sustainability element of the Passaic County Master Plan. It has 138 pages, 300 strategies, they're called, or they're actually laws, I would say. It was prepared by the Passaic County Department of Planning and Economic Development. Page 6813C reads, implement bicycles and pedestrian safety infrastructure improvements recommended in moving Passaic County and the Passaic County Complete Streets Guidelines. Now, is that why these bicycle lanes decals have been put on busy Clifton streets, and I guess it's all over the county they've been put, and our council members are against these bicycle lanes on busy streets like Clifton Walwood Road because of the safety? And in my opinion, we now have these bicycle lanes marked because of President Obama destroying capitalism, and in the future, we are to be like Europe, socialism. Even in New York City, on 55th Street between 10th and 9th Avenue, they now have the same bicycle decal in the middle of this very narrow one-way street, because I do go there to drop my daughter off at the hotel on 54th Street to London. Also, even on page 71, 16E, I shall read. Pursuant to R12699 refleet policy, incept alternate forms of transportation for county employees through New Jersey Transit Business Pass Program, promote alternate forms of transportation for employees by considering safe bicycling routes to county facilities. Cycle facility, bike rental ports, lockers, maps, bike racks, shower facilities, bus facilities, e.g. commuter shelters, and preferred parking at county facilities for alternative fuel vehicles and employees who carpool, improve emergency ride hold auction. Therefore, why do we have these bicycles? is it because we're going to be like Europe and there won't be cars? Everybody has to ride a bicycle. So please let me know.
Seeing no one at the podium.
We have one.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Hi, Freeholders. It's Joseph Intintola, Pompton Lakes, New Jersey. Want to touch base on an update. My understanding is that you acquired funds to do investigation on the Pompton Lakes contamination with DuPont. We just want to know what the holdup is. My understanding that Mr. Pasquale III has been in communication with the law firm that was used out of Newark, in Newark, where the mayor of Newark sued DuPont and won. He's been in communication with them for about a year and a half. I just wanted to know if it's moving forward and this law firm was agreed upon and they could move forward. As time goes by, things get worse. Front page, Bergen Record, Pompton Lakes contamination reached Wayne. In this article, it states that the groundwater plume that we're living in, of 540 homes, went under the Pompton Lake and went into Pines Lake in Wayne in their drinking wells. It was actually from Newark County engineering firm, engineers that requested the wells to be tested and found that were positive. My director of the Pompton Lakes CAG communicated with your health officer, and they actually sent out 129 notices to people that live around these wells that are contaminated and suggest their wells to be tested as well. So this is getting worse. And in this article, the reporter hired two geologists, one from Pennsylvania and one from New Jersey, reviewed documents from the DuPont contamination and the geomapping of the area, and they clearly said that the contamination is going through the aquifer down into Wayne, and it's only going to get worse. And now the contamination is moving from shallow and intermediate well area to deep water aquifer. And these two geologists also said when they enact the horizontal well that they're trying to install in Pompton Lakes to flush out the plume, the contamination is going to go right into Wayne and the towns further down, Little Falls, Clifton. It's going to contaminate, as Mr. Barrett said a long time ago, or Mr. James, I'm not sure, the last meeting I was at, that it's going to be a domino effect. You're not only going to contaminate, you know, Pompton Lake is contaminated, but now you're going to start doing all the towns in Passaic County. Second article is from NJDEP. They cut back their inspections by 80% because they want to go and help companies that are doing greenway, like solar panels and other green activities. So they cut back their inspections on contaminated sites and cut back the fines that they issue polluters. So now polluters have free rein. If they're not cleaning up their sites, no one is watching them. So we're asking you, we're begging you for help from the county to help our residents. It's only going to get worse, and it's going to get to a point where you can't recover from it. And then, you know, now more and more of the county is going to be contaminated, and you're going to have towns suing other towns. It's already in discussion that the Association of Pine Lakes wants to sue Pompton Lakes because the contamination wasn't cleaned up, and they want to sue DuPont. So now it's going to be town against town, and everybody's going to be pointing fingers. Thank you.
Thank you, Zach.
Motion made by Freeholder Duffy, second by Freeholder James. Roll call, please.
Freeholders Duffy.
Yes.
James.
Yes.
Lazara.
Yes.
Ford.
Yes.
Laura.
Yes.
Deputy Director Bartlett.
Yes.
Director Best.
Yes. Any freeholders have anything to say in regards to the comments?
No. Okay. Reaching out for help. Something should be, and they seem to be trying over there at Pompton Lakes, but I don't know, I don't trust any of them. Not Pompton Lakes elected officials, but what goes on Flint and the rest of it, I mean, we don't stand up and take notice. came out.
Well, we have to.
We have, but...
You know, so the question, I don't know where we're at this point.
Exactly.
But
yeah.
We have to certainly take a notice.
Thank
God we live beyond our means, as you know. So I don't, you know, I'm not sure what it's going to be.
Thank God we're not living that nightmare.
Freehold Bartlett?
I agree with what you had to say, Fielder Becker. I just wanted to answer Ms. Galage, because those bicycle markings that you're seeing on the roads are something that have been made possible from a federal grant that we received through NJTPA. Those are called sharrows, which is a combination of the word share and the word arrow. They're not actually bike lanes unless they've got a separate stripe to separate the lane from the traffic lane. What they are is driver education. They're a reminder that in any location in the county, the drivers are going to be sharing the roads with bicyclists. And one of the greatest dangers to people who ride bicycles is the drivers who are on the roads with them and may not be attentive, may not be aware that they're sharing the road. I'm not going to call him out by name, but I had a colleague at a law firm a number of years ago whose career was ended by being out bicycling and being hit by a vehicle. So those are part of the education campaign. I understand that they're unfamiliar. That's one of the reasons that we sent county staff to the Clifton Council meeting back in April to explain what the sharrows were, what their purpose is, and also why we've been commenting on that in the media as well. So it is, I think, a positive step in terms of road safety, pedestrian safety. We are trying to encourage not necessarily more bicycling, but when people are bicycling or when they're pedestrians, encourage safety, and encourage safety on the part of the drivers that may encounter bicyclists and pedestrians. Nobody's going to force you to ride a bicycle with the lot. But if you want to, we want to be sure that you're safe.
So if it's socialism, everybody will have bicycles.
So just to add to Freehold Bartlett's statement, Mr. Lodge, I hate the sharrows. That's my personal opinion. I don't know about anybody else. I'm not a big fan of it. That being said, though, bicyclists have the legal right to drive down the street the same way that we have the legal right to drive in the street with a car. So it's our responsibility as elected officials in the county of Passaic to make sure that their roads and streets are safe and to remind drivers of vehicles that they are, in fact, sharing the road with bicyclists. So if it does increase bicycling, then that's just a byproduct of policies that are already in place coming down from, again, the state of New Jersey. It is state law to have bicyclists be able to drive the bikes in the street, not on the sidewalk, but in the street. And as we do have a lot of narrow streets that can't accommodate individual bicycle lanes, they have to share the middle of the road with drivers of vehicles, with cars. So, you know, I, as much as you and I may not like it, it is a law, we have to follow it, and we are doing it. And in fact, Barack Obama did call me and tell me that you better paint these sharrows in the road or else you're going to have a big problem.
Socialism, facts-wise.
Thank you.
And where can I get that law?
Thank you, Mr. Lodge. I will provide it for you.
Okay.
We will provide it for you. Thank you, Mr. Lodge. And in regards to Pompton Lakes, it's a very complicated situation. As you know, we have a meeting around it. We've met twice. Me personally, with Pompton Lakes officials, Freeholder Duffy has also, and Freeholder Laura had some meetings as well. I don't think they were very successful. The county is limited in the type of action that we can take. This is not underneath our jurisdiction. We're still trying to figure out internally what we can and can't do. We've asked for some advice and we're still waiting to hear back, again, what we have the ability to do as a county government, because again, this is a little bit outside of our jurisdiction. So we have to figure out, there is a role for us to play. We are uncertain currently of what that role is. I know you're coming here for help, sir, and we definitely feel your pain and the stories that we've been hearing over the course of the last several years. And the fact that you've come to the county shows that you haven't gotten the support
from your local elected officials and even the federal government and your many cries for help. Trust me, we are trying to do what we can, but again, it's the things that you want us to do, unfortunately, aren't within our jurisdiction. However, there are some things that we can do. We're just trying to find out how far we can actually push this as a county entity. What's underneath our jurisdiction to be responsible for. So we appreciate you coming to these meetings and constantly remind us, and trust me, we have not forgotten about you, but it's a slight stall in the sense of what we can do, and we're trying to figure that out right now. It's a very complicated situation. As you know, the pollution hasn't happened overnight, and this is not a new battle with DuPont, the municipal government of Pompton Lakes, or with the federal government. There's a lot of paperwork that has to be going gone through, and we're trying to figure all of that out right now, sir. But thank you for coming.
Director, just if I might, I've never met anybody from Pompton Lakes, had a phone call, that's it.
Okay.
But our health department has been monitoring going through meetings as well. And we'll continue that, and hopefully the next meeting will have some sort of answer or what direction the county can do. Once again, as was going to say, you know, there's just, we're a limited role right now, and we're just exploring how far we can go and what we can.
Can't you reach out to the mayor of New York and ask him what he did to do his litigation and then solve their problem?
Excuse me, sir, I'm sorry. I don't want to get into a back and forth, but we will provide ourselves after the meeting to have a fuller conversation with you if you just hang out. Freeholder Report? I'm sorry, Laura? I'm off today. Freeholder Laura?
I believe you referenced meetings that we have meetings with our members of the community on the base.
I can't hear you.
I believe that the reference was made regarding the meetings that Freeholder Duffy and myself had with members of the community as well as the county. I can tell you what your involvement and advocacy has done. It obviously opened up our eyes more. I know that it's been an issue that's been around for a while. We all gave our words at a few meetings ago that we would move forward to get greater information, and we started a process. And we got information, but the director has stated it quite articulately, and I think definitively. We're limited. So you made a mention about something that I think is extremely important. Though no one wants to see this happen with the other municipalities, if they move forward, this may not be a bad thing. If they move forward with litigation, if other municipalities rise up, then that may be where the solution is. Because unfortunately, we haven't been able to find it here. Not because of a lack of empathy, not because of the fact that every freeholder on this dais doesn't want to resolve. But again, that's not where we're at. And I personally want to be clear, and I'm not speaking for anyone else. When I say this, I didn't even reach the limit where we're going to go. And now there has to be another step, whether other municipalities, I wanted to be very direct with you regarding that. And regarding PCTI, I know the statement was made, the high percentage of individuals that are making it to college. This is not because PCTI isn't doing their job. It's because individuals who go there get scholarships, they do extremely well in whatever trade that they're working on, and they don't have to be forced to go directly out of PCTI into this vocation. If they choose to go on to get a four-year degree and have this skill that they have received, whether in plumbing or welding or automotive, and they choose to want to get a four-year degree, that's actually very beneficial. And I would just point out that you said it was great for the school. The young individuals that were recognized for the financial literacy and the program being recognized as number one in the nation. I would just perhaps add, it was great for the county. Because these individual students, they may attend the school, but they're from the county. This financial literacy education that they're receiving, it's going to benefit students from Clifton, it's going to benefit students from West Milford, from Patterson, from Zing, from all 16 municipalities, and even further, it's going to benefit our community. So I think PCTI, and I know we continue to say it, and you come up, sir, and I appreciate the preface to statements by saying you have nothing against the county school, but I do want to once again reiterate, and I know we've all done it, that the school does good work, and until these options are available in the municipalities, I think it's vital that we have a school. So I just want to be on the record as saying that.
Thank you. And just for the record, the meeting taking place with the county boards of education and Passaic County Tech, that's going to occur at Passaic County Tech, is actually on the 23rd. So it's May 23rd. The meeting hasn't happened yet. That meeting will be taking place on May 23rd, and several of us up here will be in attendance at that meeting. That being said, I will now entertain a motion. Yes. Sure, no problem.
Council to Ms. Delash, comments on the Sharrows. I happened to be at an event in Clifton at the Knights of Columbus last week, and obviously there was a lot of Clifton folks in attendance, and the only thing I heard about, I didn't hear one thing about taxes or anything, all I heard about was the Sharrows and the total objection for placement. Now, I know that the Sharrows are meant to make everyone aware that they need to share the road with bicyclists, but it's obvious that we haven't done as good a job as we could have communicating that issue, number one. Number two, I came across a, because I'm kind of sensitive now after having a conversation with Ms. Delash, we happen to share the table, by the way, sensitive to the placement of these Sharrows. There's, for those of you who are familiar with Barnes Street, well, Barnes Street is a street that's parallel to Grant Street near the old Garden Bakery, which is now a dead end. In a 500-foot span, I counted 9 Sharrows, the color, the green color. And I have to question why the effort was placed on a road that's no longer a road. It's really a pathway. So I really would like to have the appropriate department follow up and see where these Sharrows are placed, the consistency of how they're placed, the frequency of how they're placed. It just doesn't seem right that all those Sharrows are placed.
Just that particular one, I do know that that's part of the Morris Canal Greenway that's all throughout the county and North Jersey as a whole. And there was a separate grant that was provided for that. But that particular area that you're speaking of is part of Morris Canal Greenway, and I think there was extra attention placed to encourage bicyclists as well as curb cuts that were done as part of the Morris Canal Greenway.
Way too much. Mr. The Place, would you like to come up and address some of this, sir?
Sure. Hopefully everyone, if there's any Patterson residents in here, you went out and voted already. Polls close at 8 o'clock. I want to encourage you to go out and vote if you haven't. I won't be offended if you leave our meeting. Mr. The Place.
Yes, I can answer the question. First question, one regarding the which wire is some are green and some are not. The green ones are more expensive. So you'll see that what happens is in a sequence of the Sharrow symbols, you first see a green one, and then there's white ones, and then a green one at intervals to remind you. They're brighter, they're easier to see, but they're also very expensive. So if every single symbol had a green background, it would be prohibitively expensive.
Thank you. And around Barnes Street, was I right with the Morris Canal Greenway?
Yes, that's the that's special treatment for the Morris Canal Greenway. Generally there's different treatments for different types of roads based on who's using the road and the size, the dimensions of each road.
Thank you.
I don't get putting Sharrows on a street that it's the Morris Canal.
Yeah. That's, well, Freeman, we'll get you the information about how that was designed.
Thank you, Mr. McPlace. And again, I just want to remind everybody that the Sharrows and the enhancements to our county roads are grant funded. So I just wanted to put that out there. That being said, we will now entertain a motion to approve consent agenda N1 through N33. Moved by Freeholder James, second by Freeholder Lepore. Roll call, please. Sorry, you guys look so much alike.
Freeholder Duffy.
Yes.
James.
Yes.
Lazara.
Yes.
Lepore.
Yes.
Laura. Deputy Director Bartley. Director Bass.
Yes. Great. New business, guarantee ordinance 2016-07. Can you please read it for the record?
Guaranteed ordinance 2016-07, resolution authorizing guaranteed by the County of Passaic, New Jersey, of payment of principal and interest on the governmental loan revenue bond anticipation notes series 2016, Passaic County Guarantee, City of Patterson Project of the Passaic County Improvement Authority in an aggregate principal amount not exceeding $14,395,000.
Thank you. Motion to approve guarantee ordinance 2016-07 on first reading. I will entertain that motion.
Move it.
Moved by Freeholder Laporte.
Second.
Second by Freeholder Duffy. Roll call, please.
Freeholders Duffy.
Yes.
James.
Yes.
Lazara.
Yes.
Laporte.
Yes.
Laura. Deputy Director Bartlett. Director Bass.
Yes. Personnel agenda. Moved by Freeholder James.
Second.
Second by Freeholder Duffy. Roll call, please.
Freeholders Duffy.
Yes.
James.
Yes.
Lazara.
Yes.
Laporte.
Yes.
Director Bass.
Yes. Insane motion to move the bills list.
No.
Moved by Freeholder James.
Second.
Second by Freeholder Duffy. Roll call, please.
Freeholders Duffy.
Something special, a spirit from within. It's the people that we work with, the friendships that we win.
Pride in every moment makes us feel alive. It's a feeling that we're sharing with this spirit. We will thrive.
We've got that spirit. We've got that pride. There's nothing that can stop us.
The future. It all starts with determination, dedication, and a dream. Since 1970, Passaic County Technical Institute has shown our young people just how bright the future can be. PCTI, winner of three prestigious national awards, is located in Wayne on a beautiful 55-acre campus. It is a fully accredited comprehensive high school serving all of Passaic County. We offer students 13 specialized schools and academies and worlds of opportunities. Our teaching staff and faculty receive continuous training in order to stay ahead of the ever-changing needs of the 21st century. Our diverse student body consists of over 2,000 talented young adults from surrounding communities. PCTI is much more than just a cutting-edge career and technology high school. Our award-winning students and faculty, commitment, and pride make our school a unique and exciting place to obtain an excellent education while learning the necessary skills to excel. From our academic to our career and technological programs, to our sports and activities, we're here to show you that
we've got the spirit!
My name is Samantha Matos. I'm enrolled in the Academy of Medical Arts. I'm in HOSA, which is Health Occupation Students of America. I'm in Student Council Interact, and I'm also a member of the Literary Society. I want to go to college. I've been accepted to William Patterson. I'm going to major in nursing. It's going to take me a while, but I want to be a pediatrician. I chose PCTI because I believe that it was the only school that could give me the opportunity that I wanted and provide me with the education that I wanted to succeed in the future. Through the academy, I was able to become a CNA. And as a CNA, I can go work in a nursing home, I can work in a hospital, you know, I can do private care. So I have the option of going to work and having that education, or I have the option of going to college. One thing that PCTI has taught me about myself is that they try to teach you that not everything is easy, not everything is going to be handed to you, and that you have to work to get where you want to go.
The future is bright for our students at PCTI. They are here because they want to learn and be the best that they can be.
My name is Anthony Gogler, and I'm a senior here at PCTI. I'm in the Academy of Medical Arts. Some of the activities that I'm involved in: HOSA, Health Occupation Students of America, National Honor Society, Cross Country, Indoor Track, and Spring Track.
My name is Tila Gaffner, and I am a senior. I'm in the School of Communication Arts, and I major in Advertising Art and Design. I'm involved in National Honor Society. I'm Vice President of Student Council, Rotary Interact, the Gifted and Talented program. There's volleyball, bowling, and spring track and field.
My name is Eleanor Gonzalez, and I'm a senior at PCTI. I'm in the School of Applied Technology, majoring in drafting. Also, it has taught me to be disciplined, to persevere, to pursue my goals.
PCTI students have opportunities available to them that aren't found in many high schools. Not only do our academic courses challenge our young men and women, our career and technology courses go beyond preparing them for life after high school. Placing our students in real-life job situations allow them to experience the American workforce in the classroom. We provide all of our students with the accommodations they need to achieve a high-quality education. Special needs students have resource center classrooms and are mainstream throughout the school to help ensure their success. Under the school-wide Proud to Be an American campaign, students learn the true value of American ideals. Patriotism and community service are essential elements of a PCTI education. And 73% of our hardworking students go on to further their education after graduation at top universities, colleges, and trade schools throughout the country.
Going to school here is really like another home, another family environment.
It's warm and friendly.
It's a great place to be in.
There's something for everybody in this school.
PCTI presents worlds of opportunities to students. The opportunity to work with technologically advanced machines, such as the latest family of Pentium computers, and more than 1,650 other computers for our students. Our students receive hands-on experience right in the classroom from all 13 specialized schools and academies. In our ITV studio, students can even be linked up by a satellite in real time to places all over the world. Passaic County Technical Institute offers a variety of exciting courses. Students may take honors and advanced placement courses, and even university-level courses, earning them college credits while in high school. Excitement doesn't just take place in the classroom. Our student activities and sports programs allow students to represent the school while having fun and learning the importance of teamwork. From our state championship football programs and student government to our ROTC program, there's something for everyone at the home of the Bulldogs.
My name is Dr. Sandra Ellis. I am a dentist and I have a private practice in Rochelle Park, New Jersey. High school is a major developmental component in shaping who we are and who we're going to be. PCTI helped me determine what career was going to give me the most fulfillment and enjoyment. I had an advantage going into dental school. While most others were embracing the field of dentistry for the first time, it almost seemed as if it was second nature. The opportunities to compete in the field of your choice and to test your skills greatly developed my motivation and what I wanted to do in life. I haven't seen anything like this before. You walk in, there's a bank, there's a restaurant. It keeps getting better and better. I would have never, ever been where I am today if I haven't come to a PCTI.
Dreams come true at PCTI. Our teachers, our leaders, these are the people our students look to for help and simply look up to. At PCTI, our faculty and staff take great pride in guiding each student to graduation and beyond.
I think that the instructors at PCTI are highly qualified and dedicated professionals who ensure quality education in their students.
Really push you to the limit to do your best, and I really like that.
The teachers at PCTI are devoted to their work and they are always there to help you.
They really care about you.
I would definitely recommend PCTI to any student who is interested in attaining a quality education.
Extensive training and dedication keep our teachers in touch and up to date with today's technology and demands. Being a teacher or staff member at PCTI means so much more than educating. Taking the time to be there for each and every student and to be a role model is an everyday part of the job. PCTI is ready to take all of our students to greater heights and achieve their ultimate dreams.
My ultimate dream is to become a psychiatrist and open my own practice.
I plan to open my own web design business someday.
Get a master's in art therapy.
My dream is to be on Broadway because I love to perform.
My ultimate dream is to open my own automotive service shop.
My ultimate dream is to become a certified public accountant because I like to work with people.
My future plan is to pursue a career in drafting, either in the architectural or engineering field.
To be an inspiring teacher.
To become a financial analyst.
I'm going to major in biology and then continue on to med school, ultimately becoming a plastic surgeon.
To become a CEO in a big corporation.
I want to become a pastry chef.
My ultimate dream is to become an FBI agent dealing with terrorism and homeland security.
To study musical theater.
To be the owner of an upscale salon.
I'd love to be a corporate lawyer.
My ultimate dream is to open up my own business.
I'd like to major in political science and eventually become a lawyer and at some point get involved in politics.
Yesterday, the dream began. Today, the expansion is a reality. Tomorrow, our enrollment will increase as PCTI prepares to welcome an additional 1,000 students. Dreams definitely come true at PCTI. Many new and exciting changes continue to take place. But one thing that remains constant is that
we got the spirit!
For further information and answers to all your questions concerning Passaic County Technical Institute, call us at 973-790-6000. You can also visit us on the web at pcti.tec.nj.us.
Passaic County is a diverse place with both cities and suburban areas contrasted with the scenic beauty of our very rural areas. In 2010, we attended the Complete Streets Summit. It was an eye-opener. What we learned was streets are for everyone. Complete streets better reflected our values and planning for the diversity of place, people, and choice. I guess you can say the summit started us thinking and brought us to the place that we are today, a county with a plan, policy, and an implementation strategy that we can be proud of.
A policy by itself isn't enough. We knew we needed to develop a decision-making process that outlined a vision, a policy, and design guidance that all mutually enforced each other. And that's what we did. Our policy was adopted in February of 2014 after 3 years of deliberate discussion, research, planning, and testing. The development of our transportation element of the master plan was the catalyst in the process. It created a forum for the planning and engineering departments to discuss the benefits of complete streets and how it could be applied to our county. Planning and engineering staff worked together to define a network of facilities in terms of land use and the context of each roadway that would have an impact on the feasibility, connectivity, and safety. So the Complete Streets guidelines serve as a pivot between the planning priorities and the engineering details outlined by New Jersey DOT and AASHTO. The policy was the final step in the process and has the distinction of being an implementation plan and not just a policy. The Complete Streets guidelines are just that, guidelines on how we implement Complete Streets. The guidelines aren't handcuffs and don't prescribe how everything should be done. They provide context and a decision-making tool in designing Complete Streets. It's really simple. Instead of projects standing alone on their own, they're now implemented within a framework of projects that show us the big picture of how Complete Streets work. So ultimately, I feel like we put together a very clear policy and planning framework, but success for us is going to be measured by outcomes. And in order to have outcomes, you have to have implementation.
Implementation of Complete Streets happens a few different ways and from a few different programs. We've made incredible progress through our resurfacing program. This is the low-hanging fruit that is inexpensive but very impactful. The way the resurfacing program works, we evaluate the roadway width and then decide under the Complete Streets guidelines what treatments we can do to each road. Between 2012 and 2015, we've implemented over 100 miles of Complete Streets treatments, including 33 miles of shared roadways, 15 miles of bicycle lanes, 54 miles of traffic calming, and 8 miles of road diet. A road diet reduces the number of lanes dedicated to motor vehicles and provides that width for the exclusive use of pedestrians and bicyclists. Basically, our engineering isn't pro forma book value implementation. Judgment and really thinking about the vision and our transportation system comprehensively is how we approach things. I know that people have concerns about Complete Streets, such as liability and traffic impacts. However, we were very confident in those two aspects because as long as we followed the accepted engineering standards, liability is not an issue at all. And as long as we do the proper traffic studies to assess the impact on traffic, then that also is not an issue. It's a better way of doing things, and we think it's been great for the county.
By authorizing a Complete Streets policy, we direct our planning and roads departments to incorporate these considerations into everything that they do, from major capital plans to annual restriping and resurfacing projects. The Freeholders authorization also lets our municipalities know that we'll support and work with them to make Complete Streets a reality in every city and town. I'm proud that Passaic County has the most comprehensive Complete Streets policy in the state of New Jersey. It's something we've determined supports our communities and is something that we're going to support today and going forward.
Passaic County is in the heart of North Jersey and on the pulse of the global film industry. It has stunning natural resources, urban, suburban, and rural locations, convenient access within the tri-state area, and state-of-the-art telecommunications. The Passaic County, New Jersey Film Commission was created in 2003 by the Passaic County Board of Chosen Freeholders to attract new productions, films, and TV commercials to the 16 communities that comprise the county. The commission has also created a filmmaker's resource guide. It allows location scouts, producers, and directors a snapshot of what Passaic County offers, as well as a list of local contacts throughout the county. Several productions for both the small and large screens have used the county and its communities for their sets. The Sopranos have filmed scenes all over the county, and they have given us rave reviews. Many feature films have been shot in Passaic County communities. Recently, a new film, The House is Burning, was shot in Wayne and Hawthorne. Move over, Hollywood. Here's the clip. Even popular rock groups guided by their record labels have come to our county. This is footage of the band Armor Pursuit shot in Wayne for a video of their new song, The Truth About Heaven. The Passaic County, New Jersey Film Commission also provides venues for young, aspiring filmmakers who call our county home to improve their skills. The commission sponsors an annual film festival in April, at which cash prizes are awarded to the best high school and college filmmakers.
It's such a privilege and an honor to be here today to welcome you all to our first film festival in Passaic County. I'm Deborah Hoffman, Director of Economic Development for Passaic County, and our department runs the Film Commission, a very dedicated band of experts in the film industry.
Participants get a chance to have their work viewed and critiqued by several industry professionals. The all-volunteer Passaic County, New Jersey Film Commission is hard at work raising the visibility of our county locally and nationally. Eventually, this will result in more productions within the county and increased economic benefits to the businesses that call Passaic County home. If you are contemplating a major or independent production, we want you here.
Are you a filmmaker looking for the perfect location? Then Passaic County is for you. Our county is home to 16 production-friendly municipalities that feature wonderful urban, suburban, and rural locations. Passaic County also has historical and cultural sites, botanical gardens, parklands, and castles. Easily reached and is 30 minutes from New York City. For more information, call the Passaic County Film Commission at 973-881-4427.
People who suffer from drug or alcohol addiction sometimes say hurtful things. They drive the people who love them most away. If you know someone who suffers from drug or alcohol addiction, listen. Try to hear what they are really saying. Know that there is hope and help them find their voice again. For drug or alcohol treatment referral for you or someone you know, call 1-800-662-HELP. Brought to you by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services.
Oh, honey, how was work? Good. What would you like for dinner?
Mom! Just a second, honey. I need to take care of something really quick.
What?
Can you fix this for me?
Now listen here, you ungrateful little brat. You're gonna start showing your loving mother a little respect.
Ow!
Let's go.
Ow!
Outside!
Get out of there, you stupid whore!
Get out of there, you stupid whore!
Leave me alone!
What are you doing to getting all made up, you stupid whore?
I can't take this anymore!
Get out of there, Wally! Damn it,
Wally, open the door! I know you're
innocent.
See that small shape behind your stomach? That's your pancreas.
If you're anything like me, there's a pretty good chance you didn't even know it was there.
But all that changes when something goes wrong.
Think about this. Pancreatic cancer is the fourth leading cause of cancer deaths in the United States.
More than 35,000 people will die from it this year.
The five-year survival rate is only 5%.
Picture that. Walk into a room with 100 people. 5 years later, only five are left. That is a statistic you do not want to be a part of.
These are people just like you.
People like my daughter, Bridget.
People like our mom.
People like my husband, Andy.
People like Concha, my mom.
People like me.
Like me.
Know it, fight it, end it.
Go to pancan.org.
Passaic County embraces the heritage of the nation, the headquarters of the Revolutionary War, the birthplace of American industry, a center for contemporary art. Come, explore a diverse landscape, the castles and museums, as history unfolds before you. Starting our tour at Morris Canal Park and Nature Preserve, a visitor is struck by the serene natural beauty surrounding him. Now a picture-perfect setting for artists and brides, one tends to forget that this canal was the only one in the country that climbed mountains by use of locks and inclined planes, traveling between the Hudson and Delaware rivers. This waterway, conceived in 1820, lined Pennsylvania's coal fields, New Jersey's iron industry, and New York's commercial markets. For a century, it flowed between the Delaware and Hudson rivers and extended from Phillipsburg to Jersey City. The canal was made obsolete by the railroad, closed to navigation, and abandoned in 1924. The Clifton Historical Commission approached the City Council with a defined plan and started the physical labor in April 1986 with Troop 22 of the Boy Scouts of America. As work progressed, community service people were used on a regular basis to have water in the former canal once more. At present, 19 Eagle Scouts have constructed projects in the park. Volunteers have maintained the gardens. The former waterway is now stocked with a variety of fish. More than half a dozen ducks are permanent residents and divide their time between the pond and the canal. It's a bit of history and nature in the middle of a busy city for all to enjoy. The Hamilton Van Wagner House welcomes the visitor to the pioneer homestead that once dotted what was known as the Old Aquackanock. With its graceful gambrel roof and red sandstone, the house reflects many of the characteristics of the architecture of early New Jersey Dutch colonists. The Hamilton Van Wagner House represents the ordinary people who toiled and shaped the nation, the farmer down the road, the tradesman in the village, the housewife in her kitchen, the artisan in the shop. All of the anonymous Americans who lived life as we do today, occupied in their daily work, their families, the celebration of life's joys and sorrows. These ordinary people communicate to us, their descendants, through simple objects they used in their everyday existence: the spinning wheel, a foot warmer, a crude basin, an elaborately decorated pitcher. Each room in the house reflects the different lives of the various families who called it home. Throughout the year, authentically dressed volunteers describe early 19th century life as they guide guests through the house. On Sundays, visitors can see early cooking skills demonstrated at the open hearth, cultural events and craft programs, typical of the period, as well as lectures and other events, are held at the museum. Our ancestors' lives do touch us. They reach out from the past through their possessions, now on exhibit at Hamilton House. Lambert Castle, originally known as Belle Vista, was built in 1892 as the home and showplace of silk manufacturer Catalina Lambert.
The 53-acre estate originally included the main house, a gatehouse, a carriage greenhouse complex, and formal Italian gardens. In 1896, Lambert added an art gallery and observation tower. Lambert was born to working-class parents in England in 1834. At the age of 17, he and a younger brother came to America. Lambert settled in the Boston area, starting out as a bookkeeper. Lambert gradually bought a partnership into the firm Dexter Lambert. Its base of operation was relocated to Paterson, which in 1867 was emerging as a world-class silk manufacturing center. To accompany his rise in fortune, Lambert built a new home befitting his station as one of Paterson's leading industrialists. Bell Vista was constructed of sandstone, quarried from Garrett Mountain. The interior of the castle was organized around a three-story open atrium space called the court, where Lambert displayed many of his fine European and American paintings. His art collection included works by Rembrandt, Renoir, Courbet, Monet, and Blakelock. The rooms surrounding the gallery were the entry hall, formal dining room, drawing room, music room, study, and breakfast room. These rooms were used mainly for entertaining. The upstairs rooms were used by the family and guests, and the third floor housed servants' quarters. The interior decoration of the castle reflected the eclectic taste of the Gilded Age. In 1914, Lambert was forced to mortgage his estate and art collection. In 1916, several hundred pieces of art were auctioned off at the Plaza Hotel in New York City by American art galleries, now Sotheby's. Lambert was able to pay off his creditors and managed to live out the remainder of his life comfortably at the castle until his death in 1923, just several weeks shy of his 89th birthday. The castle was purchased and renovated for park system use in 1928, and a three-story atrium closed. In 1934, the Passaic County Historical Society established its museum in the castle, which presently serves as headquarters for the Passaic County Department of Parks and Recreation, the Passaic County Historian, and the Historical Society. Passaic's Hungarian Folk Museum is located at the Reed Library on 3rd Street. The museum, in two rooms on the second floor of the public library, features an eclectic collection of artifacts of Hungarian history and culture. Our intention is to keep and preserve the Hungarian culture and folklore, says the curator. Most of the museum's donations come from local Hungarian emigres, their children and their grandchildren. The museum features colorful ornate embroideries, wood carvings, regional costumes, photographs, books and newspapers, including a Hungarian language daily, first published in Passaic shortly after the turn of the century. The exhibits are celebrations of tradition. The American-Hungarian Museum, Passaic, was established to preserve, exhibit, and cultivate Hungarian culture in one of the largest Hungarian communities in the United States. The museum specializes in community memorabilia, valuable folk art, folk crafts, costumes, embroideries, and examples of fine art. The museum also hosts special exhibits, lectures, performances, video presentations, and workshops. Paterson can be called aptly the cradle of American industry. It was near the Great Falls of the Passaic that plans for an industrial metropolis were developed at the end of the 18th century. The Lenni Lenape first found a home along the banks of the Passaic, and the Dutch settlers came here as early as 1679. However, it was not until the young American nation charted its course for independence that the industrial power potential of the Great Falls was realized. Strategically situated between the New York and Philadelphia markets, the Great Falls was considered an ideal site. In 1791, then Secretary of the Treasury, Alexander Hamilton, helped promote a private state-chartered corporation, the Society for Establishing Useful Manufacturers, SUM. It was through Hamilton's influence that the directors of the SUM located the town of Patterson at Great Falls. The new town was named for William Patterson, then governor of New Jersey. The corporation planned to utilize the falls by supplying water power through a three-tiered raceway system. The city produced textile machinery, revolvers, steam locomotives, silk, Holland submarines, Wright aircraft engines, and many more products. The SUM continued its corporate existence well into the 20th century. In 1945, its property assets, charter rights, hydroelectric power plant, and raceway system were sold to the city of Patterson. A visit to the Great Falls Historic District would be incomplete without a stop at the Patterson Museum, located in the restored Thomas Rogers Locomotive Erecting Shop. Owned and maintained by the city of Patterson, the museum was organized in 1925. Its first exhibit, displayed in the assembly room of the Danforth Public Library, consisted of natural history items donated by local residents. 2 years later, the growing collection was moved to the adjacent carriage house of former Mayor Nathan Barnett, and within a few years became one of the state's largest mineral collections. Persons with an interest in the industrial age will enjoy looking over the dyeing, winding, warping, weaving, and jacquard loom products that gave Patterson its worldwide reputation in silk and textiles. The museum has the finest collection of Patterson-made firearms in East Coast institutions. During his tenure in Patterson, Samuel Colt produced approximately 2,850 pistols. Changing exhibits complement the museum's permanent displays. For several years, the museum had featured the work of local and metropolitan artists. Individuals who enjoy historical research will also find ample documentary resources on city history, which include the papers of submarine inventor John Philip Holland, as well as his submarine, original manuscripts, and a photograph collection consisting of over 50,000 negatives and prints. The Broadway Gallery of Passaic County Community College is a vital part of the Cultural Affairs Department's program. The gallery, which began in 1979, sponsors a full schedule of monthly exhibits by a broad range of national and international artists, as well as by local artists. Recent art exhibits include an extensive retrospective exhibition by WPA artists, exhibitions by Edward Ruga, Kimberly Camp, Zoltan Hecht, Ben Jones, Alicia Morey, and many other artists from diverse cultural backgrounds. The Broadway Gallery features several important works of art that are part of the college's permanent collection. A life-size metal sculpture of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. by noted African-American artist Henry Simon is on display at all times. A 65-foot mural by artist John Traynor depicts the history of Patterson. In addition, the permanent collection contains a signed lithograph by Ben Shawn of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., an unextended loan from the collection of Cynthia Reese, five paintings by African-American artist Kimberly Camp from her Here I Talk to My Ancestors series. The gallery features monthly exhibitions of contemporary art with an emphasis on multicultural and ethnic artists. The American Labor Museum advances public understanding of the history of work, workers, and the labor movement in the United States, with special attention to the ethnicity and immigrant experience of American workers. It is headquartered in the historic Botto House National Landmark, the 1908 home of Pietro Maria Botto, immigrant silk mill workers from northern Italy. It played a major role in the reform of the American workplace. In the winter of 1913, more than 24,000 men, women, and children marched out of Patterson, New Jersey's silk mills, calling for decent working conditions, an end to child labor, and an eight-hour day. From January to July, constant mass arrests and hostile city authorities threatened the safety of the strikers and their families. Pietro Botto offered his home as a meeting place for the strikers. Elizabeth Gurley Flynn, Upton Sinclair, and other champions of the cause of labor spoke from the second floor balcony to workers of many nationalities. The American Labor Museum works to remember the sacrifices of these and other workers who have advanced the cause of working people. The museum has sponsored a variety of activities, including conferences and cultural programs. It maintains a collection of artifacts illustrating the lifestyle of immigrants and working people's involvement in the labor movement. This landmark structure contains period rooms, gardens, and contemporary gallery space for changing exhibits. The Ben Shawn Gallery at William Patterson College is a contemporary gallery consisting of three gallery rooms accommodating 1,000 visitors per year. Entering Ben Shawn Gallery, a visitor walks through a sculpture garden made up of large and small pieces. The three galleries feature changing group exhibitions based on a theme or unifying principle and one-person shows. The Ben Shawn Gallery is representative of tri-state area artists and alumni. The exhibits are curated by the gallery director and by guest curators from among the art department faculty. All the mediums taught within the department are represented in the exhibition schedule, since the gallery is an important resource for both students and faculty in the department. Painting, sculpture, photography, printmaking, textile design, ceramics, and furniture design. Here we see an alumni exhibit which reflects those careers for which students are trained, packaging, and award-winning computer animation. The gallery sponsors lectures and gallery tours. Of particular interest is Art at Lunch, which is a series of 14 thematic lectures offered on Thursdays, presented by gallery docents and art faculty. The Dye Mansion, Washington's headquarters museum, is a Georgian manor house built in the 1740s by Dirk Dye, whose Dutch grandfather came to New Amsterdam before 1641. Dirk's son, Tunis, served his county and state in an official capacity throughout his lifetime. During the Revolutionary War, he was colonel of the Bergen County Militia. This important military position brought Dye in constant communication with General George Washington. Because of its strategic position relative to British-occupied New York City and its accessibility to food and forage, the Preakness Valley was chosen by Washington as a site for the encampment of his army. In 1780, Washington's headquarters were established at the Dye home. Washington departed Dye Mansion for various campaigns. In November 1780, he and his troops left for their winter encampment. Historical research disclosed that hundreds of letters and orders were actually written at the mansion by and on behalf of General Washington and directed to senior officers as well as to the Continental Congress. Many famous men passed through the portals of the Dye Mansion besides Washington. They include Nathaniel Greene, Alexander Hamilton, Marquis de Lafayette, Lord Stirling, and Anthony Wayne. The Dye family owned the house until 1801, when it passed into other private hands. In 1930, the Passaic County Park Commission purchased the estate as part of its acquisitions for Preakness Valley Park. After restoration work was completed, the museum was opened to the public in 1934. Today, it is owned and operated by the Passaic County Department of Parks and Recreation and is open for public enjoyment year-round, where one can follow in Washington's footsteps. The Van Riper Hopper House was built in 1786 by Uri Van Riper when he married Polly Burdan. Remaining in the Van Riper family, the house was bequeathed to Uri's great-granddaughter, Mary Ann Van Riper, who married Andrew Hopper in 1872. On July 6, 1964, the house was officially dedicated as the Wayne Township Museum. The Van Riper Hopper House is a fine example of Jersey Dutch architecture. It is a 1.5-story building with 5 first-floor rooms and 4 upstairs bedrooms. Typical of the Jersey Dutch style, the house faces south and receives full benefit of the sunlight. There are 6 fireplaces in the house. Some of the floors are original wide pine planks. Open ceilings are supported by heavy hand-hewn beams. A mortar of clay, straw and hair holds the walls of stone in place. Plaster on the inside walls is 1 inch thick. The house is furnished with many fine antiques. The museum complex includes the Van Dyne House and the Archaeological Laboratory. The Archaeological Laboratory contains thousands of artifacts excavated from local sites, many dating back to Indian tribes who roamed the area thousands of years ago. Situated adjacent to the Point View Reservoir, the museum with its spacious grounds, beautiful flower beds and herb gardens offers a peaceful oasis in which to relax and enjoy a picnic. The New Jersey Botanical Garden at Skylands and Ringwood State Park is the centerpiece of a property assembled by Francis Lynn Stetson from Pioneer Farmsteads in the Ramapo Mountains. Stetson named his country estate Skylands, and here he maintained a stylish mansion of native granite, a working farm with more than 30 outbuildings, gardens, and a vast lawn that also served as a 9-hole golf course. The gardens cover an extensive area. The terrace gardens behind the manor house and the flower gardens across Maple Avenue are an easy and delightful walk. Skylands was sold in 1922 to Clarence Mackenzie Lewis, an investment banker and trustee of the New York Botanical Garden. Lewis decided to make Skylands a botanical showplace. The Stetson House was torn down, and it was replaced by a Tudor mansion of native granite that we see today. Lewis engaged the most prominent landscape architects of his day to design the garden. Most of the trees now framing the house were planted at that time, including the magnificent copper beeches. Lewis stressed symmetry, color, texture, form, and fragrance in his gardens. For 30 years, Lewis collected plants from all over the world and from New Jersey roadsides, resulting in one of the finest collections of plants in the state. In March 1984, Governor Thomas Kane designated the 96 acres surrounding the manor house as the state's official botanical garden. Included among the annual garden are the crabapple vista, the perennial border, the summer garden, the winter garden, the magnolia garden, the azalea garden, and the octagonal garden. In October 1984, Skylands was visited by John D. Bond, keeper of the gardens of England's Windsor Great Park, who manages all the garden holdings of the British royal family. Bond was so impressed by the tremendous variety of mature plants that on his departure, he took with him seeds for germination in England. Established in 1740, Ringwood is to industry what Williamsburg, Virginia is to politics. It produced munitions for every major armed conflict, from the French and Indian War to World War I. The Ringwood iron mines operated intermittently from the 1920s until they ceased operations in 1957. Martin Ryerson began construction of the present-day Ringwood Manor after he purchased the Ringwood properties in 1807 from the American Iron Company. The small federal-style home he built is a fraction of the current structure. Eventually, the property was sold to the firm of Cooper Hewitt and Company. Mr. Hewitt married Amelia Cooper, his partner's sister, in 1855. In the spring of 1856, they made Ringwood Manor their permanent home. It was during the Hewitts' occupancy that the house was expanded and acquired its current Victorian appearance and saw entertaining on a grand scale. As a wealthy businessman, Hewitt had the social responsibility to entertain his peers. These responsibilities increased during his political career, which encompass the Democratic National Chairman, a one-term mayor of New York City, and congressman from New York. Their country home became known locally as the Second White House. The present structures reflect the period from 1854 to 1936, when the Hewitts resided at the manor and used it as their country estate. One can visualize Hewitt as the lord of his manor house and 33,000 acres of property. He relaxed from the pressures of business and the congenial company of family and friends. In planning the gardens, Hewitt was inspired by the classical designs used for the palace grounds at Versailles. Today, Ringwood Manor houses a splendid collection of furnishings, Hudson River School paintings and prints and lithographs, reflecting the personal preferences of a family estimated to have amassed the sixth largest personal fortune in America. We conclude our tour in the northern reaches of Passaic County's Highlands region at Long Pond Ironworks. This rugged country, stretching from Pennsylvania to New York State, holds rich deposits of iron ore. Long Pond Ironworks was founded in 1766 as a colonial iron-making community. This colonial furnace, presently in ruins, produced iron to make armaments for the Continental Army during the Revolutionary War. Robert Erskine, ironmaster at that time, also served as surveyor general to General George Washington. Here we see the Civil War era furnaces, complete with casting house. Built by Abram S. Hewitt and Peter Cooper around 1862, this industrial complex produced iron used in making gun barrels for Union troops during the Civil War and was partly responsible for the Northern victory in 1865. This site's existing buildings and the remains of the industrial complex testify to more than 100 years of technological evolution and to Long Pond's contributions to local, state, and national history. The three structures seen here are among the surviving residential buildings at Long Pond Ironworks. Each is part of the Registered Historic District and is targeted for restoration. Visit Passaic County, where a past rich in history combines with a future rich in promise.